Now let's talk about transformations that you can apply to an image that, in a sense, change the shape of the image. But first, let's take a step back and talk about image manipulations in general. So they come in two flavors. The first is what we discussed during our lectures on image processing, which is image filtering. And in the case of image filtering, you have an input image, f of xy, and you have an output image, g of xy, and you're going to apply a transformation, but you're applying the transformation to the range of the image, or the brightness, color of the image. You're not really trying to change the shape of the image, you're just acting on the brightness of the image. So in this case, this image, you've gone in, every brightness value, you've mapped, and you get this image, but you haven't changed the shape of the image. So the techniques such as pixel processing and even convolution really fall within this class here of image filtering. And then there is another class of image manipulations, which we'll call image warping. In this case, you're actually going to act on the domain of the image. So once again, you have your image f of xy and your output is g of xy, but in this case, you're actually applying the transformation to xy. So here, you're not interested in changing the brightnesses and colors in the image, you're trying to change the shape of the image using this transformation TD. TD for domain and TR for range. So here are some global geometric transformations you can apply to an image. These are all image warps. You can translate the image, of course. You can rotate it. You can apply different types of scaling, squishing, etc. And you have affine transformations, which we'll talk about, projective transformation. You can also include in this class things like geometric distortions, such as barrel distortion. So the transformation T that you're applying in each one of these cases is the same over the entire image, the domain of the image. And it can often be described with just a very small number of parameters. So first, let's start with the simple class of 2x2 linear transformations. So here you have an image, that's your input image, and you have a point in the image P1, which is given by X1, Y1. After you apply a transformation, you end up with this image, where P1 goes to P2, which has location X2, Y2. So these kind of transformations can often be described using a 2x2 transformation matrix T. So you have X1, Y1 right here, multiplied by this transformation matrix T, which is given by this 2x2 matrix, gives you X2, Y2. And we want to try and understand what are things that you can do to this matrix that give you different types of geometric warpings. So let's start with scaling. Let's say you wanted to stretch an image or squish an image. So for example, if you have X2 equal to A times X1, where A is your scaling, and Y2 is equal to B times Y1, then you can write this again in matrix form as X2, Y2 is equal to a matrix S for scaling, times X1, Y1. And here in this case, S is A, 0, 0, B, where this is A here, your scaling coefficient, and B, another scaling coefficient. Very simple transformation. And given that S is invertible, you can go the other way. You can simply find the inverse of S and apply it to X2, and you can come back to X1 without any loss of information. Now let's do something a little bit more interesting. Let's say that you wanted to rotate an image. So let's see how rotation works. Here's your point P1, which has coordinates X1, Y1. We can represent this in polar coordinates as R and psi. So you have X1 equal to R cosine psi, and Y1 is equal to R sine psi. And let's say we wanted to rotate this point by an angle theta, right here. So when you rotate it by theta, you end up at P2, which has coordinates X2, Y2, and we can say that X2 is equal to R cosine psi plus theta, Y2 is equal to R sine psi plus theta, And you can expand these two, the cosine psi plus theta and sine psi plus theta, to get these expressions right here for x2 and y2. And you see that you can substitute x1 and y1 in here to get these two expressions at the bottom, where you have x2 equal to x1 cosine theta minus y1 sine theta, and y2 is equal to x1 sine theta plus y1 cosine theta. Again, this can be expressed using a 2x2 transformation matrix. So here is your 2x2 transformation matrix. Since it's a rotation, this time we'll call it R. So x1 multiplied with R gives you x2, and R is cosine theta minus sine theta, cosine theta. And if you wanted to undo the effect of the rotation, you apply R inverse to x to P2, which is x2, y2, and you get back x1, y1. So that's rotation. And you can do other things, such as skewing. Skewing essentially takes a rectangular image and it turns it into a parallelogram. And you can skew in any direction. Let's talk about horizontal skewing. In the case of horizontal skewing, you have x2 equal to x1 plus some m times y1. So the skewing happens in this direction. And y2 is just y1. So that can be written as 1 mx 0 1. Simple. And if you wanted to apply the skew in the vertical direction, you have x2 equal to x1 and y2 equal to my x1, my is a constant again, plus y1, and that's the matrix that allows you to perform that particular transformation. And you can do other things like reflection, mirroring an image. Let's say you wanted to take an image and flip it about the y-axis. So you have x2 equal to minus x1, and y2 is equal to y1. So you get this very simple matrix right here. We'll call it my. And if you wanted to mirror about, say, another line, which is y equal to x, the 45-degree line right here, essentially what that means is that you're going to flip the image in both directions. And so you have x2 equal to y1 and y2 equal to x1, and you get this matrix right here. So lots of simple but useful things that you can do using just a 2x2 transformation matrix. So there's your 2x2 transformation matrix. And here are some properties of this class of transformations. The origin maps to the origin. If I plug in 0, 0 here, you're going to get 0, 0 here. Lines map to lines. This is easy to show. You can plug in an equation of a line on the right-hand side here and see that it is indeed a line on the left side as well. And then parallel lines remain parallel. And finally, important, that it's closed under composition. What this means is that if point P1 gets transformed to P2 and P2 gets transformed to P3, then you can write a transformation that takes you directly from P1 to P2, where that transformation, T13, I'm reading this in the opposite direction from right to left, taking you from 1 to 3, is equal to T23 times T12. That's closed under composition.